This is Gay Science. In today's episode, why are gay men terrible drivers? Gay men have a reputation for not being able to drive, park, change lanes, or operate anything, really. Why is this? As originally discovered by Dr. Blanchett, gay men have a biological deviation in their wrists, completely lacking fundamental wrist bones that heterosexual men possess. The heterocarpals are responsible for things like casting a fishing line, basketball free throws, gripping a golf club, drinking out of red solo cups, and writing a misogynistic email. Whereas gay men develop an additional ligament in adolescence, the foveus totalis, which causes extreme mobility. With a loose, weak grip, homosexual men can't sufficiently withstand the wrist pressure of gripping the steering wheel and holding a nice coffee and supporting the revival of art pop. Gay men also spend the first half of their lives living in a simulation, so they have no sense of time, space, velocity, or any physical perspective. What's reality? Also, is this 2 feet or 20? To make matters worse, most gay men are unfamiliar with the physical space of the vehicle they're driving because that car is a rental, and their actual car is in the shop from a previous accident. This is Gay Science. In today's episode, how does gaydar work? Gaydar is a superior genetic trait specific to gay people that allows them to identify each other discreetly. It evolved out of a necessity to survive the bizarre world that heterosapiens have created with things like religion, cryptocurrency, and eating fondue at the mall. Sharing a similar science to earthquakes, gay people send and receive small vibrations through the ground that only they can feel at the same frequency as Mariah's whistle tone. This is how the monsters could locate Reba McEntire in the movie Tremors. There are many ways to use gaydar, like gay whiplash. After a first pass at eye contact, a second, faster double take is initiated and reverberates into the ground. These signals are so strong that two men could be wearing oversized polo shirts and Margaritaville boat shoes at a Tom Clancy book signing in Memphis, Tennessee, and still know the other's gay. Another method is lesbian apparel pheromones. There are some clothes, like a beanie, that look different to gay women when another gay woman wears it. The gaydar trait is only accurate in person. In an experiment at the Chromatica Institute, gay and straight men scored the same when asked to identify homosexuals from photos alone. However, gay participants did spot the other gay participants, and later, all hooked up. This is Gay Science. In today's episode, why do gay men run like that? The gay run. It's a restrained jog with a low center of gravity and a little bit of drama. So why do homosexuals look like they're being chased by the Blair Witch in a library? What's the biological reason for gay men running like they have to catch a train and just got a BBL? The gay run has two evolutionary advantages. First, it deceives predators. Gay men have survived for ages by employing a theatrical run that's surprisingly quick, confusing predators into believing this would be easy prey based on body language, while being deceptively fast. It's why Dementors can't catch Dumbledore, and how Elton John got away from Eminem after their 2001 Grammy Awards performance. Second, it's a form of nonverbal communication, as to not scare off potential female besties. It says, "Though I am running full speed at you, no need to be alarmed. I am a homosexual, and this is a safe space. However, there's probably a good reason why I'm running, and you better grab your shit, mama." This is Gay Anthropology. In today's episode, Gay Uncles. The gunkle, an evolutionary safety mechanism to counterbalance the high mortality rates of biological fathers, allowing young children to retain a next of kin protector if their dad is eaten by wolves or leaves in the middle of the night or is asphyxiated through entrapment in a grain silo. There are three subspecies of gunkle. The dedicated gunkle is an emotionally and physically available homosexual who considers their nieces and nephews a blessing. You can often find them proudly showing a video of a toddler doing absolutely nothing to another disinterested gay man. The dedicated gunkle accepts their shitty macaroni art as priceless and proudly hangs it on their fridge next to all their same-sex save the dates. The real talk gunkle treats all their nieces and nephews like grown adults. Open source and unfiltered, they opt for fast-tracking and real-world advice, like you can and should modify everything. Those girls who bully you are just gonna end up in an MLM pyramid scheme, and starting them early on who their chosen pop diva might be. For the disappearing gunkle, children are aliens. They find their mannerisms too confusing and unpredictable. Though they are usually out of the loop, they may sometimes appear to have a close relationship with their nieces and nephews because they exclusively use them for photo opportunities to attract the attention of the dedicated gunkle. This is Gay Science. In today's episode, why do gay parents raise happier kids? Not all gay people want to be parents, but those who do set the bar higher than their straight counterparts. Here's why. Gay couples can't be parents without the intention of being parents. Gay people are often satisfied with the progress of their personal goals before making this decision, so they don't place their unattained ambitions upon their children, pressuring them to live the lives they wish they had before getting pregnant. Queer people are often born into straight households that don't understand them, but they eventually know the joy of being able to live as they are, and that's ingrained in every piece of their parenting. Kids raised by gay parents are less likely to live with the pressure to be who they aren't. So it's no wonder why Christian conservatives have battled same-sex parenting for decades, because they know it's better. They don't want people to realize what happens when you're actually ready to be a parent, because it will expose their own bad parenting, which has led to childhood abuse, broken foster systems, and Ben Shapiro. This is Gay Science. In today's episode, why do gay people age better? To some, gay people tend to look much younger than heterosexuals their age. Why is it that when you meet a gay guy's straight brother, he looks like this? Humans age due to free radicals, heteronormative molecules inside the body that react to the patriarchy and slowly f*** you up. Queer people live with less of these. They have canceled their subscriptions to a dominant part of society, and now they can do whatever they want in life. They make choices based on happiness instead of expectations. If you already disappointed your family coming out, you might as well pick the career you want to have, the place you want to live in, the friends you want to be around. Heterosexuals lack this pivotal awakening and settle for a life full of unfortunate moments. Straight people say, sure, I'll go to Fogo de Chao even though I don't eat meat and I hate all of you, but that's life, isn't it? The better looking person is the one living freely, rather than the one bound to traditions. So this gay brother has aged better, because he was the one freed from the patriarchy with a gay liberation item. In this case, a used gym sock. This is Gay Science. In today's episode, why do gay men move so often? Here are three reasons why. Evasion. The same way in which gay men change their appearance to escape their issues, they'll physically move spaces to avoid dealing with their personal messes. They are especially conditioned to behave this way if they grew up in a conservative household that didn't accept them. If moving away from home solved their first big problem, it will surely solve all the others. Perpetually unsatisfied. Ambitious and impulsive, gay men are comfortable uprooting their entire lives for a new job or opportunity, convincing themselves they already have friends in that city, even though they only met at a circuit party once. They also have the distinct trait of finding flaws in every fucking thing, including apartment spaces. The walls are too thin, the street traffic is too loud, the exposed brick looks like an accident and not on purpose, my commute could be 5 minutes faster even though I'll always be 15 minutes late, my neighbors play Morgan Wallen. Any combination of these can send a gay packing. Personal development. Gay men change rapidly, and their spaces reflect their personal growth. An apartment they moved into 2 years ago might not fit the person they've become. If someone learns that a fellow homosexual has lived in the same apartment for 5 years or more, it's usually met with judgment or concern for their well-being. This is Gay Science. In today's episode, what is bi panic? Bisexuals, why are they overstimulated when around multiple genders? Also, what's with all the Doc Martens? While monosexuals are subjected to the standard laws of gravity, bisexual people exist with a gravitational pull in multiple directions. This chaotic force causes a bisensory overload and destabilization. Some common scenarios when bi panic sets in include being so overwhelmed with options you go home alone, finding an attraction to siblings of different genders and fantasizing about them, watching two people you're interested in meet and then start dating each other, seeing Eric and Topanga on screen together, or Buffy and a vampire, this threesome, and eating a box of nerds. Bi panic can be an unsettling gravitational experience. This is why some bisexuals wear horn-rimmed glasses. It's like a balancing pole for the face. Others opt for septum piercings, so the magnetic force can pull them to the Earth's core and center them. This may initiate heat buildup in the ankles, which is why you may see a bi person cuffing their pants. Or they may stop the heat transfer entirely with Doc Martens. This is Gay Science. In today's episode, why do gay men choose difficult vacation spots? After thousands of years of being exposed to straight people's low bar for fun, homosexuals have evolved to add difficulty to their lives to weed them out. Something that seems too easy sets off the gay alarm. This is the ferry and flight response. If a vacation destination requires no less than two separate modes of transportation, the homosexual body rejects it. It's why Tulum is a flight to Cancun and a two-hour car ride, and why Fire Island needs a subway to a train to a bus to a ferry, and why P-Town requires a train or a flight to a walk with your checked luggage to a pier where you take a boat to a cape and then rent a bike. If somehow a straight person ends up in the gaycation area, gays make the experience so inconvenient these heteros will never come back. It's why all the parties are in obscure locations. It's why Mykonos has exactly 17 cabs that are unreliable and your other options are limited. It's why no gay vacation spot has cell service, and why you have to book your rental house 8 years in advance. As gay men pack themselves in an isolated place that lacks resources, the ferry and flight response also fills them with adrenaline. They are all one emergency away from certain death, and there's nothing more exciting than that. This is Gay Science. In today's episode, why are gay men always running late? Let's look at three parts of the gay brain. The amygdala germinata controls social function, the desire for gay men to be at the place everyone else will be, but like, not before they get there. This means everyone's showing up 1 hour late to the pre-party, and then 2 hours late to the main party, and they're still at least an hour early. The full frontal cortex controls motivation. Homosexuals like to feel busy without actually doing anything, and rushing out the door tricks the brain into thinking they're living an active life. Gay productivity is directly related to potential repercussions, so the idea of running late morphs a homosexual into a prime state. A gay Power Ranger, embodying the champion spirit of Zayla Avant-Garde. Multitasking skills increase tenfold. Knowing they have to be somewhere, they get more done in 10 minutes than they did in a week. The limp wrist system controls habits and behaviors. Homosexuals can be held up by most anything, because their present activity always trumps future plans. They may suddenly feel inspired to work on a completely new project at the worst possible time. The gay mind thinks, my dinner reservation is in 30 minutes, now's a great time to build my first website on Squarespace for a new soap business I think I might have. This is Gay Anthropology. In today's episode, astrology gays. When you're getting to know someone and they ask how old you are, no, literally, at what time were you born and at what hospital exactly, you know it's an astrology gay. Astrology isn't really religion or science, it's a belief and a popular one across the queer spectrum. Here's why. Some queer people are unsatisfied knowing that things happen by accident or coincidence. The possibility that we're just here to live and die as a clump of cells is too depressing for them. Like watching a movie with a bad plot or sitting through an agonizing golf match, things have to matter for gay people to care. Beliefs like God created the world in 7 days, don't ask questions, only really works on straight people. Birth times, places, and planets feel real, but leave room for personal spirituality to fill in the gaps. We all have something in common, but you're still yourself. It's the perfect blend of individuality and community that queer people love so much. It also gives them a system that reinforces their own beliefs. Astrology is just a flowchart that leads someone in the direction they want to go anyway. It reinforces a good romantic match, but if the signs say no, then they're actually saying yes, but in a different way. Unless it doesn't work out, then the signs were there all along. You'll always get what you want in astrology. Some astrology gays might agree with this video, while others may write it off as the work of an overcritical Virgo. This is Gay Science. In today's episode, why do gay people either love or hate brunch? Brunch, that weekend mid-afternoon small group gathering to discuss who got bread last night over an egg white omelet. There are two gay chronotypes that operate on different circadian rhythms that dictate their preference on brunch. Those with an on-beat rhythm love it. They enjoy being connected to other on-beat people. They want to hear about everyone's night out, with the additional benefit of overhearing the night out of a stranger. To them, brunch has a strong value proposition.
1 p.m. is so relaxed. The menu is dependable.
There are drink specials.
Hot Paul might be there.
Gays with an off-beat circadian rhythm feel quite differently. To them, brunch is chuggy. If Carrie Bradshaw raved about something in 1999, it's gay history, not a current preoccupation. The food is always the same, and it feels like an obligation. Other on-beat activities they despise include organized fitness, large group birthday dinners, being around big crowds to see something pointless, gay sports leagues, and any arrangement where there's a tour guide. But there's one thing they can agree upon, that Hot Paul is really fucking hot.
This is Gay Science. In today's episode, why do gay relationships feel longer than straight ones? Time is a theoretical social construct created by humans, and more specifically, Cher. Straight relationships progress on an average curve. Gay women accelerate quickly and level off, while gay men go nuclear. By the time straight people are on their third date, lesbians have combined and hyphenated their last names, and gay men have already broken up, with their next relationship after this one. This is in part because gay men have no patience for literally anything and need you to get to the point. The homosexual experience is skipping the game's built-in tutorial, even though you could probably use it. They're at 300%, and we haven't even picked our characters yet. While a straight man is on one date, a gay man has been on several, one with his actual date, a mini-date with the server, while sending vibes to a guy at another table, whose date is also sending vibes to your date and on their own mini-date with the same server. This is the homosexual byproduct of wanting something better, sometimes to a fault. A heterochronic timeline is actually holding us back, and a homochronic one is more evolved. If society adopted this timeline, we'd cure more diseases, pass more legislation, have better national holidays, and Glenn Close would finally have her goddamn Oscar.
This is Gay Science. In today's episode, why do gay men talk like that? The gay voice.
Saturday by night.
You can recognize it instantly.
Like, I love it.
Like, people still call me ma'am on the phone.
Something away from you.
But what's the science behind this distinct vocal effect? Because they often congregate in earthquake zones, gay men harness a lot of energy. Excess energy that isn't spent relaying local drama passes to the vocal cords to initiate a high-frequency vibration. It's a pitch that all people can hear, but only gay men and Dolly Parton can understand, and it provides helpful subtext beyond what's actually being said. Sometimes these high-pitched sounds pass through the mouth into a lisp, caused by fagata dentata. This variety of gay voice is an elite form of communication, like echolocation in dolphins, and can throw sounds up to 10,000 miles away. Unfortunately, all men are bad listeners, so these messages are lost on them and are received exclusively by Dolly Parton, who's been quietly managing the chaos of hearing the voice of every gay man for decades. This is Gay Science. In today's episode, why is mom's favorite child the gay son? Moms love all their children equally. At least that's what they tell the straight ones. Why do they love their gay sons so much? Gay men have a queerer pan syndrome. They don't want to grow up, living in nostalgia, refusing to do things adults should be doing. Moms also enjoyed this time period and wish they could go back. Moms are dramatic, and gay men are good storytellers. Compare the one-word answers moms get when texting their straight children versus the elaborate drama the gay ones provide. A casual conversation will include protagonists, detailed environments, redemption arcs, and a twist ending. Moms are emotional, and gay men have a higher emotional intelligence. The gay son is sensitive to what's happening in the family and often the only one who can get on mom's level to see that dad's an asshole. They also share a mutual frustration of simultaneously being attracted to and repulsed by men. Mothers with gay sons just know more.
They understand more pop culture references, and they're the trendsetters of their group.
She's cooler than her girlfriends because she has the gay clout, which is more powerful than any drug on earth.